cansancio. Y ya ahorita en la mañana, que solo comió y empezó a toser, pegó una gran vomitada. Sí, vomitó mucho en la mañana.
¿Te sientes mal?
¿Sí? ¿No se puede dormir? ¿Tiene
piensa que lo va a inyectar?
¿Tiene calentura?
Por ratito le entra, pero más es la tos y la gripe y a veces se
quita.
Lo que
¿Te cuesta respirar? ¿Tiene problemas respirando?
Sí, es que a veces dice que siente que sí. ¿Cómo que se por eso más, ajá. Sí, usted lo escuchó anoche, ¿verdad? Que va entonces no. Y la niña de ella también. Ah,
eso, ¿de dónde es usted, señor?
Honduras el Progreso.
¿De Honduras el Progreso?
Que tiene problemas respirando.
Hijo de su madre.
Y la chiquitín
caca.
También la niña,
¿sí?
Esta niña también está mala ya.
Also the child. I'm not going to put her on camera.
¿Cuánto tiene la niña?
Wow.
Tiene
18
meses.
¿Pero qué es lo que tiene ella?
Gripa. Tiene una gripa. Y la tos se le quita como que se le viene de los pulmones. Porque a veces como que se ahoga.
¿No ha venido el doctor a verlo?
No.
No. Okay. Voy para afuera, pastor. A dar una pasada y ahorita vengo para acá con usted.
Ok.
Ok, voy a echar una caminada. How's everybody doing? I'm Oscar Blue for Border Network News at America's Voice. We were just watching right there two statements. I'm live for everybody that is watching. God bless everybody in my country of Mexico. God bless everybody. My city of Tijuana, and also God bless everybody in the United States of America. We're live, people, in the shelter Agape, where walking pneumonia and a typical pneumonia has become something normal. It has become something normal in Tijuana. Walking pneumonia, typical pneumonia, has become something normal, has become a diagnosis that doctors can give you, has become, you know, something that is pretty normal and that it's not taking care of it, you know. This is the irresponsibility of the Mexican authorities that are not checking and they're not doing the COVID tests exactly like they need to be doing. And they're diagnosing and they're telling everybody that they have, you know, a typical pneumonia. That's it. As you just heard right there, share so we can start. You just heard right there, it was a lady that her son was presenting hard symptoms of COVID. You know, diarrhea, throwing up, high fever, and difficulty to breathe. And as we are walking right here at this particular shelter, we're seeing a lot of children, around 85 children they have in the shelter, 85 right now. And as we were doing an interview with Pastor Alberto, he got sick. He was presenting a lot of the symptoms of COVID in the shelter. He was presenting hard symptoms of COVID. But he got all better. The most amazing thing right here is that a doctor from UCLA came over here, and she was helping from UCLA. She came over here helping testing people and helping them to try to know and try to say, hey, you know what, you got symptoms or you don't have symptoms of COVID, and you're possibly infected with COVID, or you're not possibly infected with COVID. Hace para allá, mijo, porque no quiero que esté cerquita, okay? So, you know, this is the situation right here. They have at a particular point and a particular break point in this shelter, they had more than 65 people that they were sick. More than 65 people that they were sick. And as you see Pastor Alberto right now, we're gonna get him right now in the interview, and I'm gonna flip the camera because they're going to start to disinfect right here. So you guys, diarrhea and vomiting are not symptoms of COVID. I don't know where you have been living, but yes, they are. And I will show you the symptoms where the hospitals over here in Tijuana, they're saying that there is. Those are symptoms. I'm sorry, but you must be on the wrong page. So I will continue with the reporting. They're about to disinfect right here, this shelter. This is one of the machines that they're using to disinfect. Pastor. Oh, so this is the machine that you use to disinfect, right? And what do you put in there?
We just put Clorox on it. We put Clorox on it, and then just like that. But the only thing is that in the city, sometimes two, three times a week, they don't give us no water. The water just goes, and then all of a sudden it comes out that you have a shortage of water. So now we don't have it to disinfect because there's no water there.
You know, this is another platform, Pastor. They were asking me that, you know, this, you were sick, now you're all better. And can you talk to the audience about that a little bit?
Well, I got real sick. I had problems breathing. My lungs weren't doing good. It came out that I had pneumonia. They gave me antibiotics. The antibiotics did not work at all. But I went to a natural doctor, and they gave me these different drops. Like that, there are different drops that you drink and everything. I had to change my entire diet. You may not, I think you do believe me, but I'm eating grasshoppers.
Oh my
and,
God.
And with honey.
Oh, that must be, that
the
tastes
grasshoppers,
good.
The grasshoppers has all kinds of B vitamins.
Oh, wow.
The B vitamins, they're very good for your health. I'm also taking green tea. There's some tea that is good for your lungs, I take that kind of a tea. They call it, it's like a little bit power that shows, like they have your hand, like muscles,
mm-hmm.
and everything. How do you call it in Spanish?
Bicarbonato.
Yeah. I'm taking that also, and then with lemon, with a lot of lemon, and then honey and everything, that just built up my entire system.
One of the people that came over, yeah, one of the people that came over here that it was helping you was a doctor from the UCLA,
yeah.
that came over here and it was testing and it was trying to help the migrants right here at the shelter because the government was not helping. And a doctor from the UCLA, you went and asked for help from the doctor at UCLA. She came over here and she was helping you, you know, with tests so she can take to the lab and then tell you know what you have.
She came down over here. They have 500 samples and they're saying anyone that we suspect, they will give it free because the Mexican government's not doing it. So they just pinched me, took a little bit of blood, put it there, and then right there in the sample, it just comes out if you're positive or not in 20 minutes. And it came out, thank God, that I'm negative. But now everything has changed my diet, the way that I do diet, the way I eat, everything has just transformed because I need to take care of myself. I need to take care of myself. I have no choice. That's what they're telling me. So if there's something that COVID taught me, and everything, I need to eat better food and everything, things that will build up my immune system,
mm-hmm.
and that I could be a little bit stronger. So I changed completely the way I eat and everything. And
now a question they're asking in the feed is that, you know, there's multiple deportations with people that they are possibly with symptoms of COVID or they already have COVID. What is your opinion on that? And if you think that is actually happening?
Well, for sure, it is happening. Maybe with knowledge or with no knowledge of a government or something, when you have a whole bunch of people together and there's no protection like right here, no one could come out of our shelter. We have about 3-4 people that could only go buy some stuff and everything here, and they ask permission to leave. I'm sorry, this is a shelter. We're under quarantine right now. We need to think about ourselves. Some of the immigrants want to go out and work because they were working. I'm sorry, I'll tell them no. Right now, you have to think about the rest. Don't think about yourself. Let's just do things correctly and everything. Don't infect no one. And we are permitting other immigrants to come into our shelter. But if they are willing to be under quarantine, and we take their temperature, and then there's something that you put your finger and see the oxygen of your heart and everything, and and well, we take all the precaution that we need.
One of the things that you were telling me is that the number, when these excrement waste and all these droppings that were happening on your back, almost your backyard with echo waste, the number of people that they were really sick with a lot of symptoms of COVID, right here, possible symptoms of COVID, to be correct, 64? Over here in 64 people.
Yes.
Wow, and after that stop, it went down only to 5.
Yes, yeah, because the toxic was so bad and everything, but when they stopped, they closed it down, the city closed it. When the city closed it and everything came up, the system started going down, and then the state reopened it, the place, but are not no longer throwing all that waste and everything, and now we feel a lot better. I believe we have about two, three children that are a little bit bad with cold symptoms, coughing, fever. And a couple of adults, but we try to monitor that, and we have them isolated separately.
And now the attitude in your shelter is completely different as what other shelters have been. A lot of the migrants right here in your shelter are saying, you know what, we're not going to cross right now to the United States. We're conscious about, you know, the spread of COVID. There's speculation of 2 Border Patrol officers, you know, getting COVID. And right now, you know, one of the things that I was surprised, Pastor, is that everybody's saying, you know, God bless the President of the United States, that he's sending, tests for, yes, you know, for people to be tested over here.
Well, yeah, well, that's one thing, you know, in the United States, the president has taken responsibility, having people test all over and everything in different states and everything, but they don't do it here. That's why, you know, it comes out that that there's a lot of people that have been tested positive in the United States because they're taking responsibility, testing people, and a lot of people, other governments, they don't want to spend money testing people and everything, and at the long run, it's going to hurt you because you're going to have some people that have COVID, but you don't have no knowledge because you never test them, and everything, and the spread could go even more. At least in the United States, you're taking responsibility, knowing who it is, who has it and everything, and the ones that has it, okay, you need to continue being in your quarantine and everything, you need to continue testing yourself. But here, the thing, that's why you see people out in the streets also here in Mexico. There are not that many people being
and
tested.
In this particular shelter, the migrants are saying, I prefer to stay. Yeah. I prefer to quarantine myself until my court date is up. Yeah. And a lot of them, you were telling me, Pastor, that a lot of them decided to go back.
Yeah, some of them decided to go back to their country because they're listening what the media says in the United States. There's so many that has COVID in the United States, but it's because they're being tested in the United States. So they're saying, I'm going back to my country. A lot of them are saying, right now, I don't want to go back to the United States until the courts are open, until they disinfect the detention centers and everything, because there's some CBP officers that have gotten infected, and also some immigrants there that have gotten infected. They don't want to get infected themselves, or they don't want to, they don't want them, because of them, some other person get infected and everything. So they're actually thankful that the courts are closed at this present moment, and also they're not receiving people because they're taking responsibility.
Yes, now, one of the other
things you could do, take responsibility.
Yes, absolutely. One of the other questions that I want to ask, and the last question, is that you went all the way to the United States to write a letter to a congressman in San Diego. And you told me the name of the congressman, I forgot, but
Juan Vargas,
a congressman in San Diego, to take care of the situation with echo waste and the droppings of excrement because of a fraud that the Mexican government is doing with the droppings of excrement over here in our country.
Well, yeah, he's from the 51st district from San Diego. We went and gave him the complaints that we filed here and everything because there's a fraud. The United States is paying millions of dollars so that they could get all those excrements and bring them to a treatment plant here so that they could treat it, and you could use that for fertilizer and everything. But the government here is so corrupt and everything that they don't take them to a treatment center. They don't want to invest and give the money that the United States is giving so that it could be converted into fertilizer, that they just come and just dump it in an empty lot, and then down by a canyon where the river's there, that It's going to go back to the United States. And the interest of the United States is that for this, don't go to Imperial Beach. But they're dumping it in a way that's going to go back to the Imperial Beach. And the Mexican state government is keeping the money. And Eco Waste is keeping the money because it's not being treated. It's just dumping it. So it's a big fraud. And that's what we brought to the attention of Juan Vargas, 51st District. And tell them, please, United States, don't give no more money to the state or to Eco Waste. All we are asking is, please, Juan Vargas, you come down to Eco Waste and inspect, okay, the money that we're giving is so you could treat it. I want to see these plants that are going to be treating all this waste and everything. And there's no plants here.
Yes.
So you could prove that, and there's millions of dollars that the United States have given, which is a lot of fraud that's being made here.
You had an isolated room we're putting people?
Yes.
Can I see it?
Sure, or there's here.
Okay, let's go to see the isolation room where the pastor was putting people with potential symptoms of COVID. Now that we were talking about it, and he just said that more than 64 people were infected right here. We go back. And we're going to go to this isolated room right now. This was the isolated room, right, Pastor?
We there's someone there. We have there, and we also have another with two children and two adults.
That they're possibly with symptoms.
They have like cold. They have a cold. They coughing and having a little bit of breathing problems.
Oh, okay, that's possible symptoms. Yeah. Possible symptoms. So, I would just walk around, Pastor. Thank you so much.
Sure.
You know, God bless you. Thank you so much. You already know how much I thank you. So I will walk around a little bit, Pastor, and I will go. I will tell you right now when I'll go. Okay? Thank you so much, Pastor. How's everybody doing? I'm Oscar Blue for Boulder Network News at America's Voice. We're live over here at the shelter. My God, Facebook. Facebook, you're shadow banning like I never seen before. But, you know, hopefully this video will get spread. As we were documenting and doing an interview with the other platform and with the network, there's a lot of things that they're wrong right here. A lot of things that they're wrong. And one of the things that I will tell you that is wrong is that the Mexican government is being so irresponsible. Being so irresponsible with not only, you know, people that they are possibly presenting symptoms, but the most irresponsibility that the Mexican government is having is with the community itself. With this Eco Waste dumping excrement in the backyard, with potential debris, with all these people breathing. For everybody that is watching and saying diarrhea and all this kind of stuff with not symptoms, you better check everything that is COVID brings. COVID for me, it was, and for me and for my understanding, for everybody that is watching, for me and my understanding, this virus, so-called virus that is out there, for me, it has been here in Mexico and also in the United States since I don't know how long. A lot of people, before COVID started spreading a lot in the United States and Mexico, a lot of people were getting sick with the same symptoms in Mexico and in the United States. They were diagnosed as walking pneumonia. They were telling everybody, walking pneumonia. And over here in Mexico, it was supposed to be a typical pneumonia or some kind of pneumonia, a bacteria. So this virus, for me, it has been here in our country for a little while, and also in the United States. Now, they have, you know, brought it up to light since it started coming out from China. But I believe that this virus has been implemented in our countries, and, you know, in my neighbor country that is the United States, and also, you know, in my country, it has been here for a little while. It has been here for a little while. So, you know, this is how sad it is over here in these kind of places. You know, you got the pastor that is, you know, that it was infected. You got children that they were, you know, I just shown you one that is possibly infected. You got, you know, a lot of people with symptoms. You had 64 at one time. God, you know, had 64 on one time that they were possibly sick. That is amazing. That is amazing. And the government not doing anything about it. The government having, you know, an under the table agreements with the state to still continue to drop excrement in the backyard. That is amazing. Another thing that is amazing. How can a judge give an okay to an eco waste company when every governmental office is closed right now because of quarantine? And you have an agreement with a waste company underneath the table to say, hey, you know what, reopen, but you know, don't stop the dumping of excrement. That is, you know, one of the things that is crazy. ¿Qué pasó, pastor?
This is our biggest baby that we have.
Let me change the camera right here.
40 days,
pastor.
40 days. This is the beauty that we have here.
40 days, 40
what,
days.
Was born
in Mexico.
Oh, she's still waiting for her number, but the baby's 40 days. She was born here at the shelter.
Born here in the shelter. Nació. Es mexicano, entonces el bebé. Sí, ¿usted de dónde, señora?
De Guerrero.
She's from Guerrero, y está buscando el asilo político.
Ajá.
Sí, por razones de inseguridad.
Sí.
Por razones de seguridad. ¿Y tiene número de corte?
Sí, tengo mi número, pues.
Está esperando el número.
Y ahorita con la situación, pues se va a esperar un poco más. Sí, la situación se va a esperar un poco más. Sí, pues muchísimas gracias, pastor. Thank you so much. This is. Let me change the camera right here. This was another migrant. She's a Mexican migrant that she's looking for a political asylum number. Right now, as you have heard, President Trump has said that, you know, those are cases that they're not essential. Those are cases that are not essential because of the COVID-19 and what is happening through the borders. Those are cases that are going to be waiting. And she is going to be, you know, be waiting on her number. It's not only that she already has a number, but she is going to be waiting on her number. So it's a long way. So God bless everybody that is watching. We are going to end the broadcast. I don't want to stay here that long. I'm a social distance from everybody, as you can see. You know, I'm all alone. I'm not touching anything. God bless everybody. We try to, you know, comply with what we said. We told you that we were going to be, into shelters today. And also, you know, we brought you the broadcast of Little Haiti and also right now, Pastor Alberto. And tomorrow we're going to have a great interview at another shelter for everybody that is watching. ¿Qué onda, pastor?
The sister wanted to say something.
A ver.
¿Este
es un emigrante? ¿De dónde es usted? You're a migrant, and I said, where are you from? And I said, she said, Honduras. ¿Cómo se siente al respecto de lo que está sucediendo ahorita con el COVID y las cortes siendo retrasadas? How do you feel right now with the COVID situation and the courts being backed up?
Bueno, pues ahorita, pues, que está este virus, pues no sentimos capaz de que nos puedan mandar a un centro de detención, porque la verdad no se ha dado una definitiva que esta enfermedad ya canceló, pues esperamos que esto pueda llegar a su final, pues, para que nuestras cortes puedan continuar.
She's saying that, you know, we are begging for this pandemic to end, because we want to go back to our courts and we want to, you know, go back to ask the asylum seeker. ¿En cuánto tiempo ha estado aquí y le ha llegado el momento de desesperación de decir, sabes qué, yo me voy? How much time have you been here? And there has been a moment that a desperation that you have said, you know what, I'm going.
Bueno, sí, pues ya llevo sobre 9 meses de estar aquí. Sí, es cierto, ha llegado el momento de la desesperación cuando ya estamos bien, porque ya se nos llegaba el tiempo de nuestra última corte, pero a pesar de que esto pues entró, pues sí, se nos vino la aflicción, se nos fue todo abajo, las fuerzas que tal vez teníamos, pero siempre confiando en Dios, que sea Él quien nos tome las fuerzas de nosotros, que nos dé fuerza, y esperando, ¿verdad?, que todo salga bien para que nuestro proceso pueda continuar adelante.
And just for everybody to know, she's a migrant from Honduras and saying, right now she's saying, yes, you know, there's been moments of desperation. There's been moments that we want to go back, you know, and we want to cross, you know, to the United States, but we're waiting to do the process correctly and in the country of the United States. Ahorita entonces va a esperar su número de asilo político. ¿Cómo ha sido su proceso de llegar hasta acá, hasta México? Y ahorita en estos momentos, ¿qué sientes tú al respecto de la inseguridad del COVID, no solamente aquí, pero alrededor de la comunidad de Nueva Aurora?
sentimos inseguros, ¿verdad? Porque no somos de acá, pues pensamos de esta enfermedad puede llegar a nosotros, ¿cómo vamos a hacer? Pues, a veces no hallamos la salida para dar una respuesta, ¿verdad? Pero siempre confiando que todo salga bien y que podamos enfrentar todo esto y podamos llegar hasta ese momento, ¿verdad? Cuando nuestra corte pueda, pues, porque hemos sufrido desde venir desde allá de nuestro país hasta acá, porque no los hemos venido porque nos queremos venir, sino por la situación que se está pasando allá en Honduras, por eso hemos decidido viajar, ¿verdad? Y al encontrarnos con esta situación, pues, no hallamos a veces ni la forma como, porque no podemos regresar y no hay una respuesta a esto, pues, nos sentimos a veces que ya no sabemos qué hacer.
Ok, pues muchísimas gracias, muchacha. Muchísimas gracias, ¿eh? Gracias por esta entrevista, gracias por este momento. As you have seen, thank you, Pastor. Thank you. You have seen her opinion is that, you know, there's a desperation. The reason why she came over here is because of the situation in Honduras. Now she's saying that there's no other option but to wait. A lot of people are asking, you know, how is she supporting herself? And if she's coming over here, that she thinks that Americans are going to take care of it. I'm broadcasting for everybody that is asking those kind of questions. I'm broadcasting on the opinions that they have on the particular situation, on their immigration, and on COVID. Of course, and absolutely, and ultimately, I'm not going to ask those particular questions because they can take it as an insult. So I'm trying to do, you know, an interview as much as peaceful as possible. But I can tell you, as what my understanding is, that right now, the ones that are taking care of her is the shelter and Pastor Alberto. We already know how the situation is as soon as they cross, who takes care of them, and what is their potential objective to cross the United States and to get a better life. That is the, you know, that is the ultimately the idea of them, and the majority of them are economic migrants. They're not, you know, I'm running away from fear, you know, I'm running away because I got this problem. You know, this is just economic migrants. They want a better life. President Trump has said and has been really emphatic on keeping the borders closed right now to only essential cases. And one of the most important statements that he has made is that immigration situation and also the situation with asking for asylum and also the situation with asking for refugees are canceled. They're not going to be attending these kind of situations and, you know, and this kind of particular situations. The asylum cases are not essential. Asking for asylum is not essential. Asking for refugee is not essential. And, you know, and and I think that, you know, how it's being portrayed on their behalf is that they don't have another option. They're going to have to wait. There's no other options. They're going to have to wait. And, you know, I have to ask all those questions that you guys are asking me right now. I've been with this in the shelters for a little while, people. You guys know ultimately what is, you know, you guys are telling me to ask some particular questions. That is ridiculous. You guys already know this. You know, you guys already know. Do you imagine me, am I doing an interview and I tell them like, you know what? Are you going to the United States because they're not going to support you? It's amazing. You know, it's amazing if you guys want me to do that. It's this, try to find out the fact and try to find out a way and try to find out what is their perspective right now with the situation with COVID-19. That is the most important thing right now. The borders are closed. Essential crossings are only in effect. And essential cases are only in effect. Those are only the situations that are they are really important right now for everybody that it knows. You know, there's no essential for refugee. There's no essential for asylum cases, asylum seeking cases. There's no essential for that. My perspective right now is that there's a little bit of desperation of what's going on. The desperation started when you start asking, you know, for asylum, and the process is incorrect because, you know, run away from your country and coming to another country that is really insecure like Mexico, and then waiting over here for a process when there's a pandemic. Imagine that. So a lot of people are going back to their country. You know, they're not awaiting in their country. They're going back to their country. So, you know, as our job right now is here to document, to interview, and to also and to also to know and understand what is the whole situation. That is our job over here. God bless everybody that is watching. God bless everybody that is watching. Thank you so much for your support as we did two live feeds right now. And also, and I agree with you, Daisy Fox, they need to protest in their own country for support. I agree 1,000% with you. You know, every country should be responsible for their own people. You know, and every country should be responsible for this, you know, for this migration. It is impossible for us to be, you know, as a country that is a third world class country, that we got more than 68 million in poverty, more than 68 million without medical care, and more than 28 million with a critical condition, that is Mexico. More than 34,000 murders in the first year of AMLO. We're number one in cartel activity. We're number two on child trafficking, and we're number two also on killings of women. And can you bring caravans? It's amazing the irresponsibility of the government of Mexico. And also, not only that, but you disrespect the border and you disrespect our neighbor by crossing immensely and massively, irregularly to another country through the front door. So, you know, it's the process itself, it is contradicting. The process itself is just, you know, it's just irregular. And the process itself is not a process. It's just, you know, international pact that immigration that is globalist, that is socialist, that is made, and you guys already know my opinion and my stand and my point of view about this massive globalist pacts that they've been making up, all these globalist agenda and the elite. You guys already know my opinion on that and my feeling on that and my perception on that. But you know, it is just these globalist people and all these socialist people, they don't care about lives. They don't care about, you know, where they're migrating to, how many countries they're migrating to. Do you think, you know, human rights and all these people, not only human rights, but, you know, all these globalist agendas and all these nonprofit organizations, where are you when they're migrating to 9 countries? It's amazing. How are you going to put people migrate to 9 countries to come to another country that is really insecure? You land on Mexico that is really insecure, the second country that is more insecure in the world. You put them right here in Mexico. And you want to help all the way over here to Mexico. Why the human rights? And why not, you know, the United Nations? Why they don't help right directly where there's a problem? Right in El Salvador, right there in Honduras. Why they don't go directly over there and try to fund and try to raise and try to help and try to prevent mass migrations? You know? Why don't they go directly to the problem? Why we gotta go all the way to the border? Why we provoke a mass migration and a regular migration when you risk people and you risk people's lives? All these globalists and all these socialists and all these governors like Gavin Newsom and all these people, they don't care about these lives. They don't care about them. They just care about funding. They only care about funding and care about money and federal funds. That's amazing. It's amazing. So God bless everybody that is watching. Thank you so much for joining me right now on the feed. Thank you so much. We will be live a little bit later on tonight. We'll be video. And also, we will be doing a super chat tonight on YouTube. Follow me and subscribe to my channel at YouTube as we are going to go live later on this afternoon. God bless everybody. Follow my partner, Conservative Anthony, at Parler and also at Facebook. Subscribe to his channel. Congratulations to my partner on the latest accomplishment on reaching more than 100,000 followers. God bless you, Anthony. Also, follow Ben Berquam and Frontline America. Also, you can follow give it a like over there in America's Voice News. Download the ad on americasvoice.com and also at also on America's Voice. It's free. You can download that, you can download that app. Thank you so much. God bless you all. Stay safe.